after their season, their busy season, what they do is they invest. They might invest in bonds or revenues. So increase their overall and bonds or in stocks. So increase their overall revenues for the year. Now, usually those companies, they would invest in something that is of very low risk. So they would invest in bonds, like government bonds. Those are very unlikely to default. They will get them some interest. And whenever they need money, they can always sell it. So right before their busy season starts, when they actually want to buy additional inventory, etc., so that they will sell them, this is what they do. They sell those investments that they made, they earn back the cash. This is what this graph is about. Rather than just using the cash to buy inventory, but if they, like a scheme resort, if they buy the inventory and early, right after the busy summer season, they will be like sitting there, those inventory items will be sitting there for several months rather than doing that. Instead of doing that, what they do, they invest, they earn additional revenues. When the time comes and they would need actual cash, they will sell them back. Okay? And in certain cases, companies might also invest. This is the third scenario, when they invest in their suppliers. So the company might invest in suppliers, in their supplier's company, to make sure that that supplier will not dump them or go somewhere else. Okay? So Best Buy, for example, they might invest in, let's say, Samsung, to make sure that Samsung will keep selling them their TVs. Because they might have a certain influence on the supplier in this case. It could be the other way around, where Samsung might, for example, invest in Best Buy to make sure that they have a certain influence that would more or less make Best Buy think twice before they dump their supplier Samsung. I'm just giving an example. I'm not saying that this is actually happening, but this is just an example to give you an idea why a company might invest in another. Okay? Sometimes a company might want to go into a new industry. Rather than starting from scratch, what they do is they invest in another company that will give them basically a push or something like that. But for example, how many of you knows Google Earth? Okay, Google Earth was a company that Google bought, okay? Google wanted to improve their mapping. They wanted to get into the maps and the whole thing, Google Maps. So they, instead of starting from scratch, developing their own systems, which they would have been able to do that. However, rather than do this, what they did was they purchased a company, and then they picked up from where that company left. They also bought like Waze on the mobile devices to give them traffic, live traffic information, rather than actually starting something on their own. They buy a company that an existing company and they use it for their own benefit. So those are different reasons why a company would want to invest in bonds or stocks. Okay? So let's see how we will be accounting for that. First one is when we account for debt investments. So we will talk about stock investments and debt investments. Debt investments is when the company invests in someone else's debts. So what are someone else's debts? Bonds. See here? Hence, bonds. Usually companies would invest in government bonds or corporate bonds, depending on how... You know that bonds are less risky than stocks, right? Bonds, it is a contractual obligation to the company or to the entity that issued those bonds to pay interest. The stocks, the company may or may not declare and pay dividends. But the bonds, they will have to pay that interest. Plus, price of bonds is much, much more stable. It's less volatile than stock prices. Stock prices will be affected by different things. Okay? Now, when a company invests in bonds, the company is not buying their own bonds. You have to understand that. When we say in the problems, in the exams, in the homework, that the company issued bonds, that means the company are issuing their own, they are selling their own bonds. They are borrowing money. When the company purchases or buys someone else's bonds, they are investing in someone else's debt, which is really are lending them money. Now we're looking at chapters 10 and 11 from the other side. Not the company who is borrowing money or issuing stocks, but the company who is buying those bonds and buying those stocks. You have to understand the difference between the two. Okay? So when a company is investing in bonds, they would need to account, they would need to make a journal entry, for example, the acquisition of that asset. They are buying a bond. It's a debt investment. Okay? So this is one thing. Then they will have to also record the interest earned from those investments. This is when they receive interest payments for those investments. The third part is when they sell those debt investments. So you have those three things. You have the acquisition is recorded. Then you have the interest. And last, we have the sale. Recording the acquisition of bonds is at cost. Basically, this is the cost of acquiring. It's the same as other assets. It's based on the cost of acquiring that asset. That would include any brokerage fees, etc., in addition to the purchase price. Interest, this is the same as we did before, but we used to do it from the point of view of the company who's paying interest. Now we'll look at the other party who is actually receiving the interest. So what's the amount of interest? We multiply the annual interest rate by the carrying value. And then we multiply it by 6 over 12 if it was semi-annual. So we multiply it by the number of months over 12. It's the same way. We calculate it the same way. However, here it's not an interest expense. It is interest revenue. So this is the difference. Now we're looking at it from the other side of the transaction. The last one is when the company sells those bonds. Here, the company will receive cash based on the fair market value, right? On the market value. The difference between the net proceeds, which are the market value minus any brokerage fees or charges or commissions that the company will have to pay. This is what we call the net proceeds. And original cost, the difference between the two will be either a gain or a loss. So let's see how those are important. Cool Corporation acquires 50 Don Inc., 8% 10-year $1,000 bonds on January 1st, 2015 for $50,000. The entry to record the investment. This is when the company made the investment. What happened? In plain English, what happened? They bought bonds. They made those investments, right? So we will debit the asset that is called debt investment. Now, why don't we call it bonds? Because if we call it bonds, we will be mixing up bonds that were issued by the company and bonds that are an investment, so that the company is investing in. This is why we use debt investments. So we debit debt investments based on the amount, based on the cost of acquiring those. So this is based on cost. Okay? How did the company pay for that? In cash. Cash will be credited amount. This is the company basically lending money to, in this example, Cool Corporation is lending money to Dom. Okay? Now, interest is paid semi-annually on July 1st and January 1st. So they purchased that on January 1st. The first interest that they would receive would be July 1st. What are they going to get? Cash, right? They will be paid those, the interest amount in cash. So cash will be debited, the interest amount. How do we calculate interest amount? By multiplying 8% by carrying value. Remember, the carrying value is the face value. And you have to take into consideration what? Discounts and premiums. Do you remember that from chapter 10? Do you remember bond discounts and bond premiums? No? Seriously? Bond premium is when the company, when the company's bonds are better than the market. So in this case, the interest, contractual interest rate will be higher than the market interest rate. They will be sold at a discount if the market rate is better than the bond rate. Okay? So in this case, we have the company will receive cash. That would be recorded as interest revenue. The amount is based on the same way, it's calculated in the same way. You multiply the carrying value by the interest rate and then you multiply it by 6 over 12. Okay? So this is on July 1st. Now, assuming that the fiscal year ends on December 31st, this is when the company is preparing the financial statements. The company has earned interest revenue. So the company will have to record interest revenue. However, when is that payment going to happen? December 31st? January 1st. So it will happen after the date of preparing financial statements. So what happens on the day the company prepares their financial statements? They have to adjust for accrued revenue. Remember the accrued revenues? This is interest that has accumulated from July until December, till end of December. But because the company is not going to receive that in cash, company will debit interest receivable, and then will credit interest revenue. The company, in this case, has recognized the revenue, the accrued interest, but they did not receive the money. They received the promise to be paid on January 1st. What happens on January 1st? The company will receive that money. So the company will debit cash and credit interest receivable. Any questions about that? This is an adjusting entry to adjust for accrued interest. Okay? Any questions? Now, assume that Cole Corporation receives net proceeds. This is when the company is selling those debt investments. So the company is selling debt investments. Okay? They are selling them for $54,000 after they have received interest payment. So we're not talking about interest. Usually, remember, you calculate interest until that moment, and then from that time forward, you look at the actual amount received. So, we need to look at the net proceeds. Here they are telling us that the net proceeds from sale of debt investments is $54,000. How much did they buy it for? $50,000. How much, in this case again, how much cash is the company going to receive? Sorry? Yes, $54,000, that's correct. So the company will debit cash $54,000 because this is the amount of cash they will receive from the sale of those bonds, of those debt investments. The company will also credit, the company will credit debt investments at cost, which was $50,000. So in this case, the company will credit debt investments $50,000. Did they sell it for higher than cost or lower than cost? Higher than cost, so it's going to be a gain. So we credit gain on sale of debt investments. Gain on sale of debt investments is reported on the income statement where? Other revenues and gains, okay? So this is a gain, which will be credited, the difference between the net proceeds and the cost. Okay? Okay. It's B. This is a bank. Their main line of business is to make those investments, and this is pension funds. This is their main job. This is what they do. They invest so that they will get more. So let's do the second one. It is the net proceeds. So think about it this way. When do you guys, if you guys buy a TV and then sell it again, when do you make money? If you sell it for more than the amount that it costs you, right? This is when you have a gain. If you sell it lower than cost, it will be a loss. Now, this is if you only paid purchase price. But remember that sometimes with assets, you have to pay brokerage fees, you have to pay, etc. So this is why it's net proceeds. This is how much you receive net after paying any charges and fees, okay? And brokerage fees and commissions. And cost, which is the purchase price plus any fees or any charges or any commissions. This is in the same way that we did with property, land, and equipment. Remember that? Where we had the gain on sale of PPE is when, so the sale, the gain on sale of PP&E is when you have, when you, the net proceeds from the sale is higher than basically the book value, right? Which includes the cost and the gain. Okay? So this was debt investments. This was when the company would invest in bonds. Now we'll talk about stock investments. And this problem here, we have the company, or here we have a slightly different issue and more complicated issue. Why? Because with bonds, the company is not involved in any way in the company where they are investing, or the entity, or the government, or for example, municipality, etc. So the company is simply lending them money. They get in return interest, and at the end they will get back their money. This is for debt investments. With stocks, the company is becoming an investor in the other company. So now the company will have the right to vote. They will have some influence, so it depends on the influence of the company, let's say. It depends on the influence of the company, of the investor and the investee. Okay? So this is why you have, and you treat them differently. The first category, you have stock investments that are less than 20%. This is where the company is a minor investor. Their influence is considered to be minimal or insignificant, okay? As a result, the company will use the cost method to record that, okay? Company in this case will declare a revenue when they receive dividends. On the other hand, when you have an investment between 20-50%, the company is considered to have high influence on the investee, on the company they are investing in. In this case, they probably have a representative on the board of directors of that company. They are probably involved in policy making and in the when the company is making their strategy, etc. They are involved in the other company. As a result, in this case, we do not record it just simply as they earn dividends. They are part of the other one. So if the company, for example, invests 40%, if Best Buy invests 40% in Staples, 40% of Staples' earnings are Best Buy's. So you do not just do it, it's not a dividend anymore, it's earnings, it's the whole part of net income that is 40% of net income will go to Best Buy, basically. I mean, technically speaking, even if they don't actually receive the cash, we're not saying that they will receive the cash, but their investment will increase, right? So this is why we use the equity method, because in this case, we're thinking about it from what's the equity of the investor and the investee. We're not talking only about dividends, we're talking about what's their equity. What's the value of their investment? What's their investment in the other company? When we have between 50 and 100, now we have a controlling. Here we have a controlling company. So in this case, we start talking about parent company and subsidiaries. The company who has purchased more than 50% becomes the parent company. The other one becomes a subsidiary of it. It's like when Procter & Gamble bought Gillette. Okay? As a result, they become, the parent company becomes Procter & Gamble. Gillette becomes a subsidiary. It's like, think about it also as household. Okay? There are certain transactions between you and your siblings. There are certain transactions between you and your parents. But in this case, you also have to think about the transactions between your house as a whole and the outside world. This is what we talk about consolidation. We talk about the group, Procter & Gamble, and their subsidiaries, and the outside world. So you have here a different thing, and we will see later on how this will happen. Okay? So it all depends on the influence of the investor and the investee. Accounting for them will be different. So if the company has or invests less than 20% in the other company, so if they have made less than 20%, again, their influence is minimal. As a result, we use the cost method to record them. And then, at the end of every year, we will make certain adjustments. So let's see. This is recorded acquisition of stock investments. On July 1st, 2015, Sanchez Corporation acquires 1,000 shares, 10% ownership of Beal Corporation, of their common stock. They pay $40 per share. So how do you record the entry? Again, of the purchase. So here we're looking at it from Sanchez Corporation's perspective. This is the company who is buying those stocks. When the company is investing in those stocks, what happens? So what's happening? In plain English, what's happening? They are buying stocks, right? So they are buying stock in cash. Basically, they are paying in cash, so the credit cash, and they receive, in return, stock investments. Again, we don't call it stocks to avoid any confusion between stocks that the company has issued and stocks that the company invested in. So here we're talking about stock investments. And by the way, a lot of companies, they do that. So you have companies that invest in stocks and bonds. And when you have more than one stock or more than one bond, they have investment portfolios. So when you hear about portfolios, this is when you have like a bundle of securities that the company will be investing in. So stock investments will be debited at cost. We have 1,000 shares for $40, and we will credit cash the same amount. Okay? As you can see here, cost includes, again, everything. There were any fees, any commission, any brokerage fees, they will be added to that. Okay. Now, the company receives dividends. Okay? When they receive dividends, in this example, it is cash dividends. What happens? They receive cash. So the company will debit cash the amount they receive. It's $2 per share. We have 1,000 shares, so it is $2,000. In debit, cash, $2,000. Okay, it is 2 multiplied by 1,000 shares. And then you have dividend revenue. This is money that the company earned from their investment. It's a revenue from dividends. So it's dividend revenue will be credited $2,000. Okay? Once again, we look at the sale of those stocks. This is when the company decides to sell those stocks. They will receive cash, how much? So here, they are getting net proceeds. The net proceeds are $39,000. This is the amount of cash they will receive. As a result, cash will be debited $39,000. What about stock investment? Credited $40,000. Why? Because it was recorded at cost. So it will be credited $40,000, and the difference between the two would be either a loss. In this example, it's a loss from the sale of stock investments. If they sold it for more, let's say if they sold it for $49,000, they would have had a $9,000 gain. Okay? Is it clear? Okay. When the company has between 20 and 50%, trust me, the only time I can work on my research and focus on it is at night. So this is why I do it. So when the company has between 20 and 50%, again, their influence is higher, we use the equity method. Now, here we're looking at what the investors' ownership in the other company. We look at it from an investment perspective, from the overall thing. We don't look at it just as dividends. So the first thing you need to do is record the purchase, right? So this is Mylar Company, a corporation acquires 30% of the common shares of that company for $120,000. This is how much cash they paid. For 2015, that reports net income of $100,000 and paid dividends of $40,000. What's the first event? The company bought stocks. So the company will debit stock investments and credit cash for the amount that it cost them to acquire those ones. So it cost them $120,000. So you debit that investment, $120,000, you credit cash, $120,000. Okay. Next, we need to look at when the company received. Basically, this is when the company is accounting for the earnings at the end of the year. The company receives how much dividends? Before we do that, let's look at it differently. So, the investees company, they have back. They had net income of $100,000. What Mylar's corporation's share of that $100,000? $30,000. This is how much their part of the earnings of that year is. Their part is 30% of $100,000. This, are they going to receive it in cash? No, right? Not necessarily. Depends. The company is not going to distribute the bet. It's not going to pay all that amount in dividends. They have 100,000 net income. That's their earnings. Mylar's corporation's share of it is 30%. That's 30,000. This is how much their equity in the company will increase. Right? Their equity will increase. Now, they had 120,000, but their equity, their ownership in the company has also increased by 30,000. So stock investment would be debited 30,000. That's their share of the earnings. Let's say that originally, to explain it differently, let's say that originally BECT was valued at $500,000, okay? They had 30% of it. Add to that So it was, add to that, the 100,000 net income. Now the value is 600. They own 30% of it. Okay? So this example, their equity has increased by 30,000. So in debit, stock, investment, 30,000. Did the company receive cash? What are these 30,000? That's revenue from stock investments. That's not just dividend revenue, it's revenue from stock investments. This is what they earn. This is their share of the earnings of the other company, 30%. What did Beck do? They paid dividends of 40,000. Okay? Their share, the share of Mylar's corporation is 30% of that dividend. They are still, they earn dividends, right? So they have, basically Beck will give them back 30% of 40,000, which is how much? Sorry? 12,000. So they will receive cash, 12,000. And they credit, not dividend revenue in this case. Their equity, we're talking, think about it as equity. What happened to their equity in the other company? It decreased, so we credit stock investment. Okay, think about it like this. We have stock investment. The company invested 100,000. Okay? At the end of the year, their share of the earnings increased the value of their investment, it increased their equity in Beck's corporation, Beck's company, by 30,000. What's their, the value of their, what's their equity there now? It's 130, right? This case, they have 130,000 in the, it's 120, sorry. It's 120,000 plus 30,000, that's 150,000. That's their equity in Beck's corporation. Beck distributed to their shareholders 40,000 in dividends. So they gave them back 30% of that amount, which is 12,000. Beck gave them back 12,000. So it will be credited to stock investment. What's the new balance now? What's the company's new equity? Just look at it. 150 minus 12, that is 138,000. You guys understand why we do not credit dividends? Because we're not looking at it as a dividend. We're not looking at it as an outsider. We're not outsiders anymore. We are shareholders. We're looking at it from an equity perspective. What's the company's ownership and equity in Beck's company? Now it's 138,000. Instead of 128,000, now it's 138,000. Any questions about this? And here, as you can see, the revenue was considered to be 30,000, not just the dividend of 12,000. It's 30,000. This is their share of net income. Okay? They did receive cash, so we debited cash. Just to remind you that when the company acquires stock investments, they debit stock investment, credit cash. And the company later on, if it is between 20 and 50%, if the company gets, when the company at the end of the year, they receive dividends. First, they need to look at it as an equity. So they add their share of net income, and then they credit the amount of dividends to the stock investment. Why? Because their equity decreased. Receiving dividends decreases stockholders' equity, right? When you as a shareholder, when you receive dividends, your equity in the company will decrease. This is why you have at the end, you have retained earnings. You have retained earnings less, so you have net income less dividends, because it decreases overall stockholders' equity. So under the equity method, the investor records dividends received by crediting what? I just answered that question in FYI in the slide before. What? Frowning face? I should draw that angry face at this point, because I just mentioned it. But I'll stick to...
You should get some beans.
Some what?
Beans.
Beans? What
beans?
Don't you dare laugh at me! Let's talk about that after class. So, holding more than 50%, this is where the company has the controlling effect, becomes the parent, the investee, the company you're investing in becomes a subsidiary or affiliate. Okay? Here, it will be important as on the parent's book as long-term investments, because the company does not intend to sell them anytime soon. Remember, so debt investments and stock investments, it depends on how the company intends to sell it soon or not. Whether this will separate current assets, basically classifying it as a current asset or as long-term investment. Okay? And later on, we'll see, like I mentioned, they prepare consolidated financial statements in addition to each company. So each company will remain a separate entity. It's not like they become, it's not, for example, again, go back to the example of a household. Every person in the household is a separate entity. But at the same time, the overall house is considered also as one big group. This is what we mean by consolidation. And just to let you know, there are a lot of companies who hold other companies, like for example, PepsiCo, they have Gatorade, Procter, etc. You have Procter & Gamble, they have Gillette, Wella Shampoo, etc. They simply have a controlling factor. Usually, why do we think about it as a controlling factor? You see? Look at this graph. Procter & Gamble, the shareholders of Procter & Gamble, they own Procter & Gamble, right? They elect the board of directors. Now, the board of directors has control over the company, over Procter & Gamble, right? Procter & Gamble, one of their assets is their investment in Gillette. So they control their investment, right? They are the majority in the shareholders of Gillette. Just for the sake of example, let's say that they have 80% of it. So they own 80% of the books. What this means is that they basically elect any board they want. Usually they elect a board that they control themselves, right? Because so it's like your boss's boss. Okay? You have your boss's boss is automatically your boss. Let's say that you have the boss's boss, the manager's manager can tell your boss to tell you to do something. So basically, they control what you can do. This is in the same way. You have Procter & Gamble's board of directors, definitely they control the company, Procter & Gamble. But what part of the assets of Procter & Gamble is the investment in Gillette. Because they have the controlling, right? What they can do is, they can actually elect the board of directors of Procter & Gamble. It will be basically their guys, their people. So they know that they will do whatever they want. So they control them. And as a result, they indirectly, the board of directors of Procter & Gamble can also control Gillette. So they control the board of directors who controls the company. Any questions about that? This is basically what I need you to understand from consolidation and from the part where we have investments over 50%. Now we get to the different categories of securities. So, securities could be trading securities. They could be available for sale. And with debt investments, they could be held to maturity. Now, trading securities are stocks or bonds that the company would like to sell them frequently. They trade them. They make money by trading them basically from the price change. So they buy them, for example, at a low price. They sell them at a higher price. They keep buying them and selling them frequently. Available for sale, those are stocks or bonds that the company purchases. However, they intend to sell them in the future, but they do not think about them as frequent trading. So they will be selling them maybe later on. So those are investments. Third part is when the company keeps the bonds until maturity date, where they get back their principal, their amount that they lent to the other company. Trading securities, again, it means that the company is selling them frequently. Now, because the company is selling them frequently, those will be reported as part of an alternate income. So originally, they will report them at cost. Every year, they will make adjustments to fair value. Okay, and the changes are reported on the net income, as part of the net income. They will go on the income statement. Now here we have unrealized gains and unrealized loss. Why? This is when the company, let's say the company purchased a stock they made a stock investment for $90,000. By the end of the year, the market value of those stocks is $97,000. If the company were to sell them now, what would be the gain? $7,000. They bought them for $90,000. They can sell them at $97,000 today, and then they would have a gain, they would report a gain of $7,000, right? But did the company sell them? This is why we call it unrealized. Unrealized gain, it simply means that if the company were to sell them now, this is how much they would report as gain. Or if they are to sell them at $85,000, the $5,000 will be unrealized loss. Because those are trading securities, the expectation is that the company will be selling them very soon. As a result, the change in price will be very unlikely. So basically, the price that you have now, the fair value now, would be very, very close to the amount that the company will actually sell them at, because they intend to sell them pretty soon. So this unrealized gain or unrealized loss will be reported on the income statement. So this will be reported on the income statement under other revenues and gains or other expenses and losses. Okay? Now, companies, they have the cost and fair value. The first time they make the investment, the cost at that time would be the fair value, right? So the cost is what the company reports those investments at cost. At the end of every year, they will have to make adjustments to get to the fair value. Remember that usually assets are reported always at cost, with the exception of securities, because the prices the fair value amounts can be easily found. Okay? And easily determined. So in this example here, for example, you have Yorkville company bonds. The cost was $50,000. Fair value now, if the company is to sell them now, then it will sell at $48,000. So basically, you have a $2,000 unrealized loss. If the company were to sell them now, they would lose $2,000. Cut that company stock, the cost was $90,000. The value, fair value now is $99,000. There is a $9,000 unrealized gain. As a result, you look at the overall thing, the investments here. Cost was $140,000, fair value is $147,000. If you were to sell everything now, those trading securities, the company would realize a gain of $7,000. The company did not sell them, so the company will debit, look at it as unrealized gain. So the company will debit. Fair value adjustments. That's an allowance account. So fair value adjustments, trading. This is important. Fair value adjustment for trading. Because when it is for trading securities, unrealized gain or unrealized loss will go to the income statement. You'll see in a second what's the difference between this one. So there's a difference between trading securities and available for sale. Trading securities, it's supposed to be very close to the time the company actually sells them. As a result, they will automatically be included on the income statements. So to adjust for the fair value, if there is an unrealized gain, you credit fair value adjustment trading, and you debit fair value adjustment trading, and you credit unrealized gain. If it's a loss, you do the opposite. You credit unrealized loss. Why am I doing that? You debit unrealized loss, and you credit fair value adjustment from trading. Okay, so you flip them. Remember always, the loss would be on the debit side, a gain would be on the credit side. Available for sale securities, those are securities that the company tend to sell, but they don't have to be, not necessarily within 1 year. If they were to be sold within 1 year, they would be reported as current assets. If it's more than 1 year, it would be long-term investments. Okay, here, the idea is that the company is not going to sell between the time the company is preparing the financial statements and the time the company actually sells them. When they sell them, the price might be very different. So the market value might be very different from the value now. In order to avoid the volatility in net income and income statement information, companies, they do not include unrealized gain or unrealized loss on the income statement, but instead they include it on the stockholder's equity section. So in this case, it's going to be done in the same way, it's calculated in the same way. Basically, you look at the difference between fair value and cost in the same way. The only thing is, where do you report it? This one is, it might be longer, so you do not report it on the income statement. So you have in this example, again, we have bonds and stocks that are available for sale, securities. You have cost and fair value. The difference between the two is a loss. Is it realized? You have to think about it. Is it realized? No, it's not. The company did not sell them. The company still owns them. They still own them. As a result, this is unrealized loss. So unrealized loss will be debited, this amount. However, you call it unrealized gain or loss equity, because it will be reported on the balance sheet under the stockholders' equity section. So it will be debited, the difference between fair value and cost, and fair value adjustment available for sale. Remember, the first one was trading. This one is available for sale. Always remember this. Available for sale, it will be on the balance sheet under the stockholders' equity section. So available for sale is with equity. On the other hand, trading will go on the income statement. So for example here, some of other home corporations' investment securities are classified as trading securities and some are classified as non-trading securities. Okay, so this is non-trading is also available for sale. So the cost of each, this is again available for sale. Available for sale. Non-trading also available for sale. Now, once again, you look at the difference between the two. So for trading securities, there is an unrealized gain of 1,300. This is the amount that will be changed. At the beginning of the year, fair value adjustments, basically before preparing the financial statements, at the beginning of the year, fair value adjustment from trading account had a debit balance of 9,200. So what's the journal entry here? You have 9,200 was on the debit side. Okay? We have a gain, which is on the credit side. The difference between the two is 7,900. So we have, in this case, you have on the debit balance, as a result you put, it is unrealized loss for 7,900. And we credit fair value adjustment from trading, securities, the same amounts. When we look at the other one, it is available for sale. We know that available for sale will go, so this is income and trading. Second one will be equity, and this is, again, available for sale. Okay, now you have, in this second one, the beginning balance was a credit of 5,000, was a credit 5,750. We have unrealized gain of 2,600, as a result, you add them up together. 8,350. It's on the credit side, so this is unrealized. It will be credited to unrealized gain, equity, and then you debit fair value adjustments from available for sale securities. Any questions? Yeah, let's skip this one. So this unrealized gain on available for sale securities will be reported on the stockholders' equity section on the balance sheet. Now we talk about short-term investments. Companies that would report those securities as short-term investments if they are readily marketable. So they are also called marketable securities because you can easily sell them, immediately sell them, plus the company intends to actually sell them within 1 year. So the company intends to sell them within 1 year, and the company can actually sell them within 1 year. They are readily sellable, and this is why they will be reported as, in this case, as short-term investments under the current asset section. Long-term investments is all the other securities. Any security that does not, any stock or bond that does not meet those two conditions would be reported as a separate section under long-term investments. So marketable securities bought and held primarily for sale in the near term are classified as company intends to buy them and sell them in the near future. When you hear near future, it is trading securities. You intend to sell them in the near future. Okay? Now, how do we present unrealized gains and losses and realized gains or losses? Realized gains or losses, they are under other revenues and gains or other revenue, other expenses and losses. Unrealized gains from trading securities would go on the income. Unrealized loss from income from the trading securities also will go on under other expenses and losses. So not all unrealized gains or losses will go on the income statement, but all losses and gains will go there. When we have available for sale securities, losses or gains, it will be unrealized loss on available for sale. It will be reported as a separate item under the stockholder's equity. If you have an unrealized loss, it will be subtracted from stockholder's equity. If you had unrealized gain, it will be added to stockholder's equity. So here, for example, assume that Dawson has common stock of 3 million, gain earnings of 1,500,000, unrealized loss on non-trading securities of 100,000. You just add common stock and retained earnings, then you subtract the unrealized loss. This will give you the actual stockholders' equity. This is how the assets section looks like. You have current assets. If you have short-term investments, remember, short-term investments are investments that are readily marketable and the company intends to sell them within 1 year. Those will be reported as short-term investments. The company will say that they are reported at fair value. Because remember, originally they were reported at cost, and then every year the company will adjust for fair value. Then you have investments section. This is the long-term investments. The company will explain what those investments are. So you have investments in stock of less than 20%. Because it's less than 20%, it will be reported using the cost method, so it is fair value. They also have a separate item for 20 to 50% owned, and those are reported at equity. Okay? And then you have, this is the stockholders' equity section. Again, you have paid in capital, you have retained earnings. At the end, you have also, you add any unrealized gains or you subtract unrealized losses. Finally, you would have here if a company has any restrictions, but here you will find that those are restrictions. It's explained in the notes. Any questions? Okay. So identify where each of the following items will be reported in the financial statements. Interest earned on investments in bonds. This is interest earned. When you hear the word earned, it's an income statement, and this is other revenues and gains. It's interest revenue. Fair value adjustment available for sale. Available for sale will go on the balance sheet. Stockholders' equity section. This is a fair value adjustment. Fair value adjustment is the allowance account that will go under the investment section. This is available for sale. And then you have unrealized loss on available for sale securities. Unrealized loss will be on the balance sheet under the stockholders' equity section. What about gain on the sale of investments? Income statements and other revenues and gains. And unrealized gain on trading securities, the same thing. Any questions? Okay, let's do this one here. So here the company has two types of securities. Company is selling stock B for 10,000. They are selling it. What's the entry to record the sale? Okay, so that's good. I'll give you a smiley face for this. See here, you have cash is debited. The amount that this is from the proceeds, right? They sell it for 10,000. So this is proceeds. This is based on the cost, and this is the difference between the two. Okay? Here the company has common stock of 5,500,000, retained earnings, etc. What is the total amount of stockholders' equity? So think about the accounts that will go on the stockholders' equity statement based on the balance sheet on that section, stockholders' equity. You have common stock, retained earnings, unrealized gains on trading securities will go on the income statement. This one will go on the income statement. So we do not include it. From available for sale, it's going to be is 200,000. So the answer will be 5,500,000 plus 3,000,000 plus 200,000. Minus, sorry. Thank you guys. At least you're paying attention. Minus 200,000. Okay? Unrealized gains from on trading securities will go on the income statement. Remember that. If a company acquires 40% common stock, which method will be used? Do we use the equity method? Yeah. Okay. This part, like I said the other day, like I said earlier, I'm not going to include it in an exam. I'm not going to test you on this part. I just want you to understand something about consolidation. This is again looking at the overall group as one big, like one household and the outside world. So when the companies prepare financial consolidated financial statements, they actually prepare them from the balance sheets of each company. So Procter & Gamble and Gillette, they will have separate balance sheets, and then from those ones, they prepare the consolidated balance sheet. That, to do that, they eliminate any transactions between parents and the subsidiaries. Any intercompany transactions will be eliminated. Okay? What does this mean? Like in this example, assume that on January 1st, 2015, Powers Construction Company pays $150,000 for 100% of Certo Brick Company. Okay? So look at those financial statements. This is the parent company, the subsidiary. The combined data is not the correct data. You do not just add everything because you will be overstating assets. You will be overstating your numbers. Why? This amount here, the 150,000 as investment, it is also same as the amounts here. You're actually including them twice, so you are overstating. This investment is the equity in the other company. So the correct amount, data would be, the consolidated data would be to remove intercompany transactions, which is this one, will offset the 150,000. Okay, here we're looking at it as an overall group, as a household. So the owners of Procter & Gamble, they already own this equity, which already has, basically in it, it has the equity of the other companies, because they own 100% of it. The companies, they usually use a worksheet like this. This is the worksheet that you will be asked to do in the exam. This is the one that you will be asked to prepare. It's for the consolidated financial statements. Guys, I'm kidding. I just told you earlier that I'm not going to test you on this part. So what? What? You're not listening? You are not listening, right? Okay, now I have your attention. This is a worksheet where the company actually eliminates any intercompany transactions. Okay, and that will give us the consolidated data, which will be used to prepare the consolidated financial statements. Just one last thing. Imagine that, basically, let's assume that the company pays more than the actual net, basically the actual amount. So in this case, instead of paying 150,000 for those two, the company paid 165,000 for investment. So the investment is more than the equity. This is means that the company actually have in mind, or they know that certain assets are underestimated. So they are undervalued. As a result, what they do, they add this amount either to the amount to the asset that they have, that they know for sure they were under evaluated, and then they add the difference to goodwill. This is where the company will actually use the difference to goodwill. Last year, for example. Okay, they know that, for example, property, plant, and equipment was valued, in their opinion, at higher than the book value. They will add that amount to property, plant, and equipment. The difference will be added to goodwill. Okay? Have a good day.